tell in advance, but the objective is to put on the web after the workshop. Okay, then as a workshop opening, I would like just to remind perhaps the origin of this meeting that starts from the point of view of roboticists mainly, and then by a collaboration with colleagues here, and mainly Jean-Bernard Lasserre, who is an applied mathematician, specialist of algebraic geometry and optimization, numerical optimization, and my colleague Nicolas Mansart. Okay, then for the opening, I would like then to give you this robotics perspective of the topic, which is very, very broad, which is the geometric and numerical foundation of movement. So let us start from the beginning, the mathematical foundation of not of movement at large, but of robot motion. What is the historical perspective we can give very, very briefly? First of all, let us start by the idea, what is a motion? I think that everybody will agree that a very simple definition is a continuous function from time to space. Then from a mechanical point of view, if you are considering this very abstract system, this is just a simple manipulator working in the plane, then two angles are necessary to characterize this position, and in fact, this mechanical system lives on a torus. Okay, then there are two angles, then this is a torus. And for the roboticist, when he wants to plan a collision-free motion between that configuration to that configuration here, in fact, he translates the problem, which is a problem in the physical space, in a problem in the configuration space of the system. Going from that position to that position, in fact, it can be summarized by how to go for that point from that position to that one. We, by this transformation, there is no more bodies. Okay, the bodies in the physical space completely disappear for the benefit of asking the motion of a point. And of course, the obstacle in the physical space are translated into obstacle in the configuration space. If you succeed in doing that, and this is, of course, a challenging problem, then the problem is very simple here, because you have just to move to move a point. And then you solve the problem on the torus here, and once you have solved the problem on the torus, then clearly it's possible to see that there is a motion that corresponds to the objective you have fixed. Then this idea, which is to say something which is particularly obvious, but as all main contribution, there are obvious. That any admissible motion for the 3D mechanical system for bodies in the space appears as a collision-free path for a point in the configuration space. And this is the seminal contribution by Thomas Lozano Perez from MIT at the beginning of the 80s. And then for the roboticist, then this is the well-known piano mover problem. And then the question from a computer science point of view, for the computing point of view, that the problem fundamentally, the motion is a continuous function. Then the question is the question of the computation. Then how to translate a continuous problem into a combinatorial one? Is that possible? Is it what is the nature of this problem? And then again in the 80s, it is proved that the piano mover problem is decidable. Okay, then it can be solved by a computer, and this is the contribution by Jacob Schwartz and Mika Sharir. At that time, they were both at the Courant Institute in New York. And what is that kind of proof? Most of the time, follow the principle of reduction. That means that we say that this problem is equivalent to another problem. And in fact, the contribution of Mika Sharir and Jacob Schwartz has been to say, okay, this problem is related to the decidability of elementary algebra, okay, which has been proved in the 50s by the mathematician Tarski. Okay, then, great. This is, that means that the problem is very well formulated. Okay, it can be solved on the computer, and then let's continue. But the question is that, in fact, if we look at the computational complexity, then we are at the second level, and the problem can be solved. Okay, right. Now, what is the complexity? And the complexity is truly an issue. That means that with the classical method of the real algebraic geometry, it appears that what we may expect is that the problem is doubly exponential in the dimension of the space. There is no hope to solve the problem. And then there were, during that time, several tentatives to solve very specific problems. That means motion of polygons in the plane when the dimension of the space is okay. With the 90s, there is a change of paradigm where the people try to use another type of techniques. I would like just to show you. This is what I call the amazing efficiency of empirism. Instead of trying to prove that your algorithm is complete, is performant, forget about these constraints on the solution you want to perform and try other solutions. And this has been the seminal contribution by Oussama Khatib, who is now in Stanford, and you want to go to the goal, you put some attractive potential, some repulsive potential, and then you can see that it works. It works in general, but sometimes there are some local minima, okay? Then this is, but it may work in for reasonable, under reasonable hypotheses, for instance, of convexity, of, okay, then there may be some nice results, but there is no more guarantee to find the solution. And then the real empirism has been done by Barakan and Latombe in Stanford, where they combine this idea of the gradient descent with some random walk. Then how it works? Then you start looking at the solution by using the previous method, and it fails. And then you start by walking at random. Okay, you walk at random, and then you stop, and then you start again with a gradient descent, and it works. It works pretty well. Then what will be the number of loops to succeed in reaching? Okay, then this is another story. And for that, you have to ask a physicist, or it's a very deep mathematics, which is related to statistical physics. But in general, you can prove that if there is a solution, the probability to find a solution in finite time, this probability is equal to 1. And then this contribution has been the very beginning of, then it has been proven by Barakan and Jean-Claude Latombe at Stanford. And after that, there are other algorithms that appear both in Utrecht and in Stanford, Mark Overmars, Lydia Cavrati, and Peter Zvezda, and many, many people, including us at LAS. And you can recognize perhaps here the James Kuffner, who is the former responsible of robotics at Google. That means that working in this area is very productive in terms of career. Huh, if you then this has been very, very, very efficient. And if we go back to the system, at the very beginning, the contribution of Thomas Lezanne-Perez has been to say any admissible motion for the 3D mechanical system appears at collision-free paths for a point in the configuration space. But what about the converse? What does it mean? The converse is any path in the configuration space is admissible motion. And the converse is true for holonomic systems. I don't want, of course, to introduce here the notion of holonomy. I like to define the holonomic system as a system which is not non-holonomic. Okay. That means that the pertinence of the concept comes after, okay, in the second slide. At that time, if the converse is true, and this is true for a system like this, then it works pretty well, and then you can make automatic programming of serious robots like that one, okay, which is a welding robot making, and you can see that there is a lot of possibility of collision, and this trajectory has been computed with that kind of algorithm. But now we introduce perhaps one of the topics we want to speak about during this workshop is the origin of the optimal control in this robotics problem. It came from the non-holonomy of a certain system. And the non-holonomy is very simple. This is your car. A car can move everywhere in the space in the absence of obstacles, of course, but it is non-holonom. That means that there are some motion of the car which are not allowed. From another perspective, the car has 2 degrees of freedom, the steering wheels and the accelerator. The brake is the same as an accelerator from a mathematical point of view. Then you have only 2 degrees of freedom, but you move in the 3D space in the sense that this is 2 parameters for the position and 1 parameter for the orientation in the system. And then there is a differential equation, which is the rolling constraint, okay? And this differential equation is not integrable. That means that your system is non-holonomic. That means that the converse is not true. Any collision-free pass for a point is not an admissible motion. Then this is particularly difficult for mobile robotics. And then this has been in the 90s, this problem, how to park a car. And what appears is that to park a car, you need some deeper mathematics here where you are using a Lie bracket of vector fields and so on. You have to combine that, and it's another story. But the question is how to make the combination between the computational point of view that is at the origin of the motion planning problem and the differential equations here that define that system here. And we succeed in doing that. We succeed. Why? Because these systems are small space controllable. Small space controllable, that means that in speed of these constraints, it's possible to maneuver and then to approximate any trajectory, any path which is collision-free in the configuration space. Okay, and the mathematics to prove that comes from the differential geometry. And more than that, it's possible to prove a combinatorial result. That means that the number of maneuvers to park your car, of course, varies as the size of the free space. But how it varies? It varies exactly as the inverse of the square of the size of the free space. Okay, that means that if the you reduce the size to park your car, then the evolution of the number of maneuvers varies as the square. And if you add some trailers, in some case, it may vary as the Fibonacci number of the trailers. It's completely crazy and very nice. And what is the key for that? The key is to understand the underlying metric that gives that. And this has been done by my former student and now colleagues, Philippe Souer, who compute the exact shape of the non-holonomic metric. I would like just to show you that picture to try to understand what it is. A car evolves on the plane, then you have 2 parameters for the position, okay, then to locate the car on the plane, and 1 parameter for the orientation. That means that the configuration space is S2 or R2 times S1, if you want, times 0 to pi. Okay, and then now the question is, I am asking here about this metric, is to understand what is the wavefront then that means that the boundary of the accessible space, when I give you 1 centiliter of gasoil, or if you give you some level of energy, okay, then what is the evolution of this wave front? Then this problem, which is an optimal control problem, is very, very difficult. And in general, we don't know how to solve it. And we have been very lucky, because at some stage, by applying the maximum principle of Pontryagin, blah, 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 it's possible to integrate in this specific case a specific differential equation that allows us to conclude that. And then if you are asking about the evolution of the metric, we, this year, for the first time, we played a game to print. This is very effective. Here, this is the non-holonomic metric. This is the Subriemannian metric of the car-like evolving in the plane. And you can see how it evolves. And then I let you to understand what happens when the distance tends to the infinity. Here, this is 0 to pi. Then at the infinity, of course, it converges to a cylinder here. Okay? But this is a unique case where it's possible to solve that. And that means that power and limit of optimal control. This was very nice. The problem for the car-like is very well solved. But in general, the techniques are not extensible at all. Then the first topic of discussion, perhaps for this workshop, is to discuss this issue. There are specialists here in the room of the geometric control theory, and there are specialists of numerical optimization, then how to combine these tools here. Second aspect I would like to address is the path versus motion planning and control. The initial picture I give you of our problem as a roboticist is a geometric picture. A motion is a path. Okay, but a motion is not a path. Okay, but at the very beginning, we start with that, and with this amazing efficiency of the probabilistic method, it has been possible to solve that kind of problem here. You have an anthropomorphic system here, and collaborating with a mobile robot, and what you have to understand is that all these animations that includes walking, that includes rolling, that includes obstacle avoidance here, all these animations has been computed in an automatic way by the probabilistic method I mentioned. And then we start presenting that in some robotic conference, and some Japanese colleagues told us, okay, but it's possible to apply to humanoid robotics. Oh, come on, and the main difference between this small movie and humanoid robotics is the presence of the gravity. There is no gravity at all here. There is no force there. But let us try. Let us try, and then it was in 2006, and in 2007, it has been possible to demonstrate that this motion on HRP2 robot, this is the robot you will see tomorrow, okay? Of course, there is a knowledge of the environment, but previous knowledge given by some sensors, I don't detail the perception aspect. The environment is very well calibrated, but all the trajectories here has been computed like this. Then the main difference between with the previous movies is that here there is some feedback to prevent the robot falling. And the origin of this feedback is just the stabilizer of the humanoid robot, which is included in the robot. Okay. Then we continue in that perspective, and then we demonstrate some challenging issue in terms of motion planning and control. Then here, we are in Toulouse, which is the pink city, and with a lot of bricks, and then we start with this experiment. Then you can see how to compute the trajectory is very challenging problem, and believe me, there is no miracle. Hein? We give the algorithm the intermediate position here. Okay, the intermediate. But what is very interesting here is that the robot is able to approximate the path which has been computed here in such a way that it avoids the obstacles. Okay? Then first we solve the geometric problem, and then we provide a control architecture that guarantees that it's possible to approximate as close as I want the geometric path which has been computed here. Then in the two-state approach. Okay, but now the question may be much more challenging here, and this is work in progress. The method here cannot apply in that case. Why? Because the motion is highly dynamic. It's a highly dynamical motion, and then in that case, the question of computing a path first and then execute the path, this paradigm cannot be applied here. We have to revisit the planning paradigm by just computing the necessary posture, that means that the contact point here, we may, and then the critical issue is to generate in real time dynamic, stable motions. And then here, this is the second topic we would like to discuss, planning and control versus control-based planning, how we may reorganize that in terms, here I was presenting the two-step approach. First we plan and then we execute. How it's possible to have a decisional process that includes the control at the very beginning. Okay, let us continue. Now I would like to introduce the recent problem we are addressing in robotics, which is not recent, of course, in control, which is the inverse optimal control. Then we start working with Professor Alain Berthoz for several years to try to understand what is the shape of the locomotor trajectory. Then, a working man is like a car. There are two parameters to locate the body in the space, and one parameter, angular parameter, for the orientation. Then what we did is we use motion capture techniques to compute the reachable space of the walking man. Then the walking subject is entering this door here, and he has as a protocol and as an instruction, a goal, he has to go through this arch, and this arch can be positioned at some point in the space and oriented at a given. Okay. Then we record a lot of trajectory with more than six subjects. We have the 14 kilometers of data, and then first we prove that there is a stereotypy. We are, all of us are working the same. But the question is to understand the shape, the geometric shape of the trajectory. Why are we using this trajectory instead of another one, another possible one? What is the underlying principle of selection for that trajectory? And this principle, okay, we assume that there is some optimality principle. But what kind of optimality principle? And then for that, we consider a given system, and I didn't write the equation of the system, which is quite obvious, with three controls, one which is U1, U2, and U3, which is the rotational space. And this is an inverse optimal control problem in the following sense. We have a system. We observe trajectories. We assume that these trajectories are optimal, and we want to compute the cost. And for that, there is no miracle. We express the cost from a basis of a functions here, which is very simple. This is a combination of the control, okay? And then we try to compute the coefficients here, alpha 0, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, okay? And if you are considering only this control here, without considering that one here, only that one, then it appears that you may deduce by the structure of the basis you are considering, you may deduce that this trajectory should be symmetric. And the experience showed this is not the case. That means that the basis of the function at the very beginning was wrong. We start making any computation just by analyzing the geometric consequence of the choice of the basis. It's possible to deduce that this basis is wrong. And then, in fact, we have to add another parameter here, which is the bearing angle. And then, in that case, it's possible to have a cost, which seems to be quite reasonable in the sense that there is a physical interpretation. Because 1.2 is less than 1.5, what does it mean? That means that we prefer to go forward. Okay. It's quite obvious. And you minimize the psi, that means that we look at the goal. Okay. But with this very simple law, it's possible to rebuild all these trajectories here. Okay. Okay, then let us continue in terms of the second issue, the relationship between robot motion and robot action. And this is an example we work in 2012. And this is that one. Can you spot the difference between these two motions here? Here the robot has to pick a ball, and here the robot has to pick two balls. Of course, we position at the position here of that one. Okay, I don't know if you see the picture here. We start with this first experiment. And with this first experiment, the robot has to pick this object. Then the motion of the left hand is just to maintain the balance of the robot. Okay, but at the very end of this experiment, we fix that position, and we ask the robot in the second experiment to reach that position and that one here. That means, in some sense, the same final posture. Okay, that one here, the final posture is not fully determined. This is just how to pick that ball here, while here it's fully determined. Okay, but the motion looks very similar. In fact, there are not similar. If you are looking the difference, there are some slight difference here, okay, between them. And why? This is obvious for the roboticists because we know the law we have implemented to reach a goal. To reach a goal, we implement a very naive law, which is we try to reduce the error to the goal. Okay? Then we know that in the first experiment, only the right hand will be submitted to that law. In the second experiment, both hands will be submitted to that law. And if we compare now the distance to the goal for the right hand, in the first experiment, this is that evolution. In the second experiment, this is that evolution. That one is decreasing, exponential decreasing, not that one. That one is not an intentional motion. This was not the intention of the robot to reach that goal, while that one is an intentional one. Okay. Then that means that in that sense, it's possible to make a reverse engineering to understand with double quote what the robot is doing. And now the third subject and the last subject of discussion is the relationship between natural motion to be discussed with all the neuroscientists here in the room and these ideas of inverse optimal control, which is quite controversial. And then let us go to discuss that. And then if I summarize, here there are the three main topics that may be discussed during this workshop between mathematicians, neuroscientists, and roboticists. And this is just an introduction to wish you welcome to the workshop. It is open. Thank you very much. There are time to for the discussion. You know, I wanted to make the introduction quite short, just to give you a picture of what. Then, is there some complement? I can make some comment about the program. You have all the program. But, as you can see, we privilegiate the fact that there should be some place for the discussion. And that means that this is not a 10-minute talk. This is really talks where you may explain, you may talk about what you want, and please try to reserve some part for the discussion. Okay. Then is there some preliminary questions? Then Jean, tu veux donner everything is recorded. Hein? Take care of what you want. Pierre Brice.
Thanks, Jean-Paul. Yes, you've been speaking about planning and how you combine planning and controls, planning and acting. How much do we need planning? In most situations, we just act. And then sometimes we just say, oh, wait a minute, let's stop and think about it and make a plan. But most of the time, we, as humans, don't plan, we just act. So how much do we really need planning?
Let us take my favorite example of walking. And you know that we will be in opposition. What we try to develop as a research, okay, let us summarize that. How the humanoid robots are working. And then to work, then there are some conditions of stability, the center of mass should be projected on the polygon support, and then a way to work is to translate the center of mass over the polygon support, and then to move the other feet here, to place here, to transfer the center of mass, and that this will be a quasi-static motion. The humanoid robot, and the Shapitu, is not working like that way. It's working like this. And like this, obviously, there are some phases of the motion where the projection of the polygon or the center of mass is not over the polygon support. But what the criteria we are using is to control that the zero moment point can be addressed by a force sensor in the feet. We control, in fact, the zero moment point of the robot. There is a very an equation between the center, a differential equation between the center of mass and the zero moment point, which is a differential equation which is highly nonlinear, very difficult to solve, blah, 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 blah. We made the hypothesis that if the center of mass is moving on a horizontal plane like this, without changing the attitude, then in that case the relationship becomes linear, it's possible to integrate, and then this has been the very first pattern generator for humanoid robot. This is the explanation why the humanoid robot are working like this. After that, there are some improvements, and you will see some improvement in the demonstration of HMP2 and the demonstration by other colleagues, that it's possible to work like this. But again, all these techniques are based on a kind of preview control. That means that you are anticipating the way the position of the feet on the floor. You anticipate. To compute the trajectory of the zero moment point, you should do that by anticipation. And then you should anticipate where you are putting the neurophysiology intuition, and this is the deep work I'm doing with Professor Albertos for 20 years. For me, a little bit less, before understanding that what we are imagining, and then that. But we are not planning in advance when I am working like that. I'm not planning in advance. There is another strategy. What we try to better understand is to change completely the paradigm and perhaps to see, and this is the project we call the yo-yo man, to try to rebel the underlying will in the body that allows us to roll and not to walk. Then this is a crazy project. We have some preliminary results on that. But the idea is that we are not planning the placement of the feet. The placement of the feet is a natural consequence of the mechanic of the walking. And this has been already experienced with the passive walker. If you are considering the passive walker, that system are not computing in advance well. Okay, then the answer is very long, but this is the perfect example here of the question, what is the part of planning and what is the part of control? And obviously, sometimes, you have to take care of putting the feet. And this is why we introduce the notion of texture of a floor, until, for what kind of context, it's possible to work without thinking. And sometimes, of course, we have to take care, right? And then to work like this by making the planning.
Question?
Yoshi?
Yes, just 5 minutes for the two questions.
So, I have a comment in addition to what you said about control and planning. The, maybe just after you, I also entered the problem of non-human existence. And after the discussion with my colleague, we realized that the whole system definitely needs planning in group. So that is the problem of the essential non-human systems, like bipedal work or any electrical locomotion system. So the non-human system has very strong constraint of control. And sometimes the people look at the very local level of constraint. But for human animals, of course, we have more scope of the long range effect. So that kind of planning effect that we do in the promotion of any movement must be inside control. So I think the planning is very essential in control.
Emmanuel Todorov, it was Yoshi Nakamura, and just to introduce the
So I think maybe if you expand the notion of planning a little bit, because you know, people who study biology, it's sometimes hard to sell to them the idea that you know, even if you're planning, what is it that you're planning? Just because something is moving in a complicated way doesn't mean it was planned. So if you look at you know, the leaves and the trees outside, they do really elaborate things, nobody planned them. And what's different between our motion and theirs is that we accomplish things that are somehow useful for us and they don't. But there are other ways to accomplish things that are useful for us. So for example, what's called a central pattern generating biology, some little oscillatory circuit that makes you walk, is that a plan? So it's not a plan in the sense that you mean it here, but I think in some more general sense it's a plan because some process had to consider the infinite variety of pattern generators out there. Almost all of them are completely useless. They're not part of the nervous system, and there are a few of them that actually work, which is what we use. Right? So that in itself is some kind of process of continuous improvement, whether it's evolution or if you believe in intelligent beings up there, whoever, somebody planned which pattern generator we want to use. And it's an optimization process did it. So we have to extend the notion of planning to the space of control policies and not just to trajectories that you might generate using them. And then if you put it that way, it's not clear what the alternative. The alternative is to wire up a random nervous system or write down a random computer program and run it and hope that it works well. It's not going to work. Somebody has to make it work.
No, it was a comment more than a question.
next speaker is Emmanuel Todorov from the University of